Okay, so how is everyone today?
Good.
Good? Peachy. So, any questions about things that we already went over or programs that were already assigned last week? Any questions about any previous matters? Yes?
For the doubling technique, and it always seems to be one less than what it was supposed to be. For example, if it was supposed to be like 16, x would just lose x to the fifth, it would be x to the fourth. It threw me off a little bit.
I guess I don't understand your question.
Neither do I.
So, for the doubling technique,
yeah.
Essentially, there's kind of two cases that you have to deal with. One case is the case when I'm asking you to double up to a number that happens to be a power of 2. Okay? And then another case is I'm asking you to quickly get to use the doubling technique to get to a number which is not a power of 2. So which one?
The first one.
The first one. So 5 is not a power of 2.
No. From like x to the 5 equals x to the 4th. It was like that to like coming from like 16 x's, but instead of it being 16 x's, it would be x to the 4 is 16 x's.
Okay, well let's do a quick example of this. And suppose that I want you to compute, say, 27x, and I want you to use addition only, and I want you to use the doubling technique. Okay, so suppose we have this. So I've given you an x. So I could say, well, x1, this is x. X2, I'll say that this is x plus x. And of course, in our brain, we know that this is really 2x. Right? And then and this should be x1 plus x1. And x3 is x2 plus x2. Well, that one is 2x, and that one is 2x, so what is this really? 4x. So this is really 4x. And then x4 is x3 plus x3. And that's really 4x and 4x, so what's this one?
8. Like, I understand that, because I wrote it out on the thing, on the program. It was always one less than you're supposed to be on. But it never matched.
Okay. I'll be glad to look at what you've written in the program, but without seeing it, I can only speculate.
Well, you just imagine, like, the computer screen.
I can only speculate without seeing it. So this one would be 16x, and so should we double again?
No.
Why not?
That's not how that works.
Well, why not specifically?
Yeah,
we'd overshoot, yeah. Right? So we want to use as few pluses as possible. So now the next one is we can collect prior results. Okay, so then we can say x5 plus x4, so that'd get us to 24 x's plus x2, that gets us to 26, plus x1, that gets us to 27 x's. This is the more or less optimal if you're using doubling only. This is as good as you can do. You could do better than this. You could use fewer pluses if you were trebling. Because then you do x plus x plus x.
Oh.
And then you do x plus x plus x. That's 9. And then you do x plus x plus x. That's 27. So you could get away with, you could do even better. But doubling, this is as good as you can do. Other questions? Yes?
How do grades work in e-learning? Because there's a lot of zeros, but that seems like it's for just
There's no grades in e-learning presently. Let's be clear. There's a multitude of columns, of rows in the gradebook. None of them are how I assess your performance.
Okay.
So presently, the way to assess your performance is if it's passing the tests, then you've done it. Now, there's going to be slight matters that we're going to come back to once we get enough programs going and you have enough programs that aren't so sort of trivial in a sense. Just like when you write English prose and you submit it to your literature instructor, you know, or Mrs. Harris in seventh grade or whatever, okay, you have to put spaces between words. And then words are organized into sentences, and sentences organized into paragraphs, and then there's vertical space between paragraphs. So when you read a book, literature, what's written is expected to have a certain shape. Spaces between words. You know, spaces between words is a relatively recent invention. It is. You laugh. But for example, if you read the Dead Sea Scrolls or something, or if you read, say, the original letters in the Christian tradition, there's no spacing between those words. It's just a jumble of letters. Context only tells you that here's where one word begins and another ends. It's a great invention to put spaces between words. It's a terrific idea. And recent. Geologically speaking, I suppose. Okay, just like literature is supposed to have a certain shape when you look at it, source code also is expected to have a certain shape. And I haven't told you really what that shape is, so I don't expect you to do it yet, but we'll go over that. But otherwise, if it's passing the test, you've done it. Okay, yes?
What are the tests? I think you forgot to give us a syllabus.
I posted a syllabus on Coursebook and on e-learning.
Okay.
And so by test, I think that you mean exam.
Yeah.
There are no exams.
Okay.
We're just going to do lots and lots and lots of assignments.
Okay.
So then by test, what I mean by test in this context is that when you write a program, I included another program that validates whether or not your program is correct.
Okay.
And I'm calling that the test.
Will there be a final exam?
Maybe, but probably not. Probably not. Because in the end, you know, to reiterate, the purpose of this course is for you to gain practical fluency with this tool. In principle, it would be almost impossible for me to organize a final. Right? Now I want to watch you have a conversation with MATLAB. And I can't watch all of you simultaneously. It's like, it just doesn't work. Good. Other questions? Okay. So now we need to talk about iteration, which is the real strength that computers have. And it is the one place where computers do and will always excel beyond human capacity. Okay, so computers are not good at doing much of anything that humans are quite excellent at. But what they can do very quickly over and over and over again. Okay, so that's what we're talking about today. So iteration. So now, I want you to know how to do iteration in MATLAB, but I'm going to couch the introduction in a math topic since this is a math class. So, definition. Of the factorial. So, for example, I'll do an example down here before I give the exact definition, because many of you will already know what this is. So here's a math statement.
And the way you say that is 5. Right. Not really, right? So what is this?
5 factorial.
5 factorial. So what is this? How do you compute it?
5 times 4 times 3 times 2 times.
Very good. So the way that you compute this in practice, right, is 5 times 4 times 3 times 2 times 1.
Or even if you were really doing it in your head, right, you wouldn't even do the times 1. Because human beings don't do that. You know, we're cleverer than that. And if you were to do that, that's 120. Okay, so in principle, I could ask you to evaluate any such factorial, and you could do it just like this. Okay.
So, yeah, 5. So here's the definition. Let n be a member of the integers, and n is greater or equal to 0.
So what I mean is a non-negative integer. Okay.
Then n factorial is defined in the following way.
There's 2 clauses to the definition.
It is equal to 1 if n is 0. And it is equal to n multiplied by n minus 1 factorial if n is greater than 0.
Okay. So the first clause of the definition is one that even first and second year math majors sometimes can't remember. What is 0 factorial?
1.
It's 1. Okay. So
to write this slightly differently, 0 factorial is 1, and n factorial is n multiplied by n minus 1 factorial.
Okay, so in principle I could now say compute whatever factorial. And just as a reminder, factorials get big very quick. Right. So then 10 factorial is a really big number, but 100 factorial is, you know, probably more than the number of protons in the universe. Okay, it's a lot. Okay. So let's compute factorial, and we're going to compute it tabularly in a table, and we're going to do it in at least 2 ways.
So compute this by table. Because remember, in the end, we're going to have to convince MATLAB to do this. Okay, this is a perfectly understandable human thing, but let's get MATLAB to do it. Okay. We're going to initialize a table. We're going to have 2 variables. We're going to have P, and we're going to have N. So here, this is where you start. So these are the initial conditions. They're provided for you. So factorial is a product. Factorial is a product. So what is the empty product equal to?
1.
Why is the empty product equal to 1? Is the identity of
multiplication,
right? So the empty product is 1. What's the empty sum?
0.
What is the empty function application?
The identity function.
The identity function.
So P is initialized as 1. And let's say that we want to compute the factorial of 5. Okay, so what we're going to do is we're going to repeatedly update both columns. We're going to repeatedly update both columns. And the way we're going to update them is if n is non-zero, that means that we have to produce a new row. That means that there's more work to do. And if there is more work to do, what we're going to do is we're going to take the present value of p and multiply it by the present value of n. And then we're going to decrement n. What does that mean, decrement?
Decrease by 1.
So, in the end, we're checking, is this non-zero? So is it non-zero?
Yeah.
Yes. So now, what's the new value of p?
5.
And what is the new value of n?
4.
One row. Okay. So do we need to make another row?
Yes.
Why do we need to make another row? N is non-zero. So what are we going to do with that n? Or p or whatever. So someone tell me what I'm supposed to do because I already forgot. Okay, multiply the present value of p by the present value of n. That product will be 20. And then what?
Decrement.
Terrific. Okay. Do we continue?
Yes.
Yes. Why do we continue? Because n is non-zero. Okay, so then we take the present value of p and multiply it by the present value of n, that's 60, and then decrement n. Okay, do we continue?
Yes.
It may seem a little forced for me to say, do we continue? But in the end, remember, the goal is we want MATLAB to do it. And MATLAB is all the time asking, you want me to keep going? Do I stop? Go? What do you want me to do? Okay, so then the present value of p gets multiplied by the present value of n, 120. And then now, if you're a human, you say, "Ah, oh, okay, I get it. I'll stop." Right? But we said the stopping condition was that n is going to be 0. So, are we going to stop? Do we need to make another row?
Yes.
Yes, according to the way that we said things. So multiply the present value of p by the present value of n and decrement n. Do we continue?
No.
No, we stop now. Okay, so any question about the construction of this table? Notably, what I'd like for you to see is that, you know, you have this nice pattern 5, 4, 3, 2, 1, 0, and this is the answer for the factorial. Okay. Also notably, I'd like to point out that this is not really the way humans do it if you just ask them to do it. Which is to say that if you wanted to compute 5 factorial, I bet you would have done instead 2 times 3 is 6, 3 times 4 is whatever that is. Okay, you do it like that. Okay. So that is to say that when a human does it, typically you count up instead of down. At least that's my observation about humans. Yes?
Is that because we have limited working memory?
You know what? I don't know what the psychological reason is. But when you ask someone, you know, just as an experiment, go ask one of your colleagues that's not sitting in here, say, could you just real quick, say it out loud, how do you compute 5 factorial? Dollars to donuts, they do 2 times 3 is 6, 6 times 4 is 24. They do it like that instead of 5 times 4 times 3 times 2 times 1. So let's do it in the human way now. That is to say, let's have a new table. And remember, what this table is doing, this is a specific case, but it's an abstraction for being able to do it generally. Okay, it's an abstraction for being able to do it generally, which is to say that I could have initialized this n to be
any other value than 5. And in principle, this would have worked, because we just would have kept asking, do we keep going? Do we keep going? Do we keep going? So I could have made it anything.
So now let's do it sort of like a human would do it. But in this case, to do it like a human, you need 3 columns. Because you've got the present value of the product. You've got the present value of the product. You've got the present value of where you are. And then you've got where you want to be. Okay, which is to say that the empty product P is 1. The empty product P is 1. And then humans typically will start here with I is 1 and N is 5. So now n is going to be a constant. So here we're decrementing n. But now in this table, n is going to be constant. And instead of decrementing n, we're going to increment I. What does increment mean?
Increase by 1.
And now what's going to be the stopping condition?
5.
Yeah, when I is the same as n, whatever n happens to be. So what we're going to do now is we're going to say, okay, I'm going to multiply P by the present value of I, increment I, and just copy N. Okay, so 1 multiplied by 1 is 1. Increment I, that's 2, copy N, that's 5. So do we keep going? Yeah, we have to keep going. So now the present value of P is 1, the present value of I is that, so then multiply those together, 2, 3, copy. Do we keep going? Yes. Multiply the present values of P and I and store that in P, that's 6, increment I, 4, copy N, that's 5. Okay, do we keep going? Yes. So then multiply the present value of P and I and store that in P, that's 24. Increment I, that's 5. Copy this is 5. So we need to go one more for it to be right. So we got to go one beyond. Okay, so then multiply the present value of P and I and store that in P. 120, increment I, copy N, and now we observe, oh, okay, we've done it now. I's bigger than N, so we stop. So what I'd like for you to observe, to compare and contrast these, is that notice that this counter, okay, it's counting up. It's counting up, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, and this counter is counting down. Okay, and that in the end, that's sort of the fundamental difference between these, if there is any difference at all. Also, I'd like to point out that this table, in a sense, requires one less column, right? Because we know that the stopping condition for this one is always when this one is 0. That's always the stopping condition. Whereas the stopping condition for this one is whenever I gets bigger than N. So for this one, in a sense, you have 3 variables you have to be keeping track of, P and I and N, whereas this one, you just need P and N. Now, on modern computers, that's almost irrelevant, to be honest with you. And in a intelligent programming language, it could optimize this away entirely. So you it would turn this one into that one. Okay, but MATLAB is not such a thing. So this one is counting down. This one is counting up. Okay.
Okay.
So now the question is, how do you get MATLAB to do such a thing? Okay. So, to that end, we need to talk about what a conditional is. Conditional. A conditional is, in a programming language, is a statement that turns on or turns off the execution of certain lines of code, only if something happens to be true. Okay? So in abstract mathematics, math class, we have the notion of true and false. For example, here's an equation in mathematics. Okay, this is not MATLAB. How about this? 5 equal 5. So in the first place, is that an equation? Yes, it is an equation. Now here's a different matter. How about this one? 5 equal 8. Is that an equation? It's not technically. It either is or it isn't. It is an equation. It is. Now, some of you have just a slight revulsion to that and say, now, wait a second. But let me put, if you don't know the right words to say, let me give you the vocabulary. Yes, these are both equations. They're both equations. This equation evaluates to true. This one evaluates false. So equations are objects which can be evaluated. This one evaluates to true. This one evaluates to false. Is this an equation? Yes. Is it true? No. There's nothing immoral or unethical about that. Okay? So it's an equation. And when you write something like this, for example, x squared is equal to 9 in mathematics, okay, is this an equation? Yes. And now you can evaluate this equation at certain values of x, and it will be true or false. So if we evaluate this equation at x is 0, is it an equation?
Yes.
Yes. Is it true?
No.
No. There's nothing unethical about that or immoral. Okay. Now, we all know, because you're all satisfying the prerequisites to be in here, there are, among the reals, precisely two solutions to this. What are they?
3 and -3.
Positive 3 and negative 3. Okay, because if you evaluate this equation at positive 3, you'll square positive 3, the left-hand side will be 9, the right-hand side will be 9. Is that an equation?
Yes.
Yes. Is it true?
Yes.
Yes. If you evaluate this at negative 3, you'll square negative 3 to get positive 9. The left-hand side will be 9, the right-hand side 9. Is that an equation? Yes. Is that true? Yes. So a solution, when you say in your other math classes, when they say solve this equation, what that means is among the universe, usually the reals, sometimes the complex numbers, find all such things that when you evaluate this equation, the result evaluates to true. That's what that means. It's sort of a pedantic way to say it. But now that we're dealing with MATLAB, we've got to be pretty pedantic. Okay. So now, in MATLAB, we have the following. Is that, now what I'm going to write is a slight approximation of what's happening in MATLAB. So this will be enough for now, but it is not the widest possible truth and description about what's happening in MATLAB. Okay. 0 is false, which is to say that when I show you how to ask MATLAB if something is true, and you give it a zero, it'll say, that's false.
Non-zero. Is true.
Now, there's lots of this is just replete with historical baggage, but this is the way it is. So, to MATLAB, is 7 true?
Yes.
Yes. What about -7?
Yes.
Yes. What about 0.7?
Yes.
What about 0.000, several zeros and then a 7?
Yes.
All of those are true. How about zero?
False.
That's false. Okay.
So, if you were to go to the command console in MATLAB and type the following. If you were to type 5 equal equal. So that's two equals in a row. There's no space in between them.
But I've got to put a little bit of space so that you can see that there's two of them.
But there's no space character in between those. 5 equal equal 5.
If you were to go to the command console and type this, in the first place, so from a mathematical point of view, I want you to treat this as an equal. So I'm making analogy to this one. So is this true?
Yes.
Yes. MATLAB will respond in this way. It'll say, answer? True. So as far as MATLAB is concerned, anything that's not zero is true, but when you ask it and for to consider the truth, if it is true, it'll give you a 1. Okay?
If you ask it, if you say, well, how about 5 equal equal 8?
So I mean by analogy to this one. So in the first place, mathematically, is this an equation?
Yes.
Yes. Is it true?
No.
It's false, right? So how will MATLAB respond to this?
Answer is zero.
Okay. So now, as an aside, now this is, you may be wondering, if you don't have any prior programming experience, what's with the equal equal? Is one equal not enough? And the answer is, no, it's not. It's not. So in among humans in math class, human beings are just phenomenal language users. And we're able to disambiguate ambiguous grammars using context-sensitive information just from birth. It's one of our inheritances, each one of us. But here's the difficulty, is that let's consider the following thing in math. So I could write this, x equal 9. The meaning of this statement, if we were in a pre-calculus class, depends entirely on the context. Because I may be asking, before this line occurred, I could have said, well, x is 12. And then here, this would be me asking, is it true that x is 9? In such a case, the correct response would be, no, it's not true. So, that is to say, if it looks like, if the discussion looked like this, if we said x is 12, and then we did some stuff, and then I said x is 9, this would be me asking, well, is x 9? And the answer would be, no, it's not. Whereas, if this is the first, you know, if this is the first thing that, you know, is at the top of the page, that means that we're taking the value of x to be 9, just like we're taking the value of x to be 12. So there's two different things that are used in mathematics, written mathematics. Equal means two different things. In this case, here it is a test for equality. It's a test for equality. In this case, it's an assignment. It's to say that I'm talking about a symbol, x, and we're going to give it the value 9. Give the symbol x the value 9. So this
is a test for equality or equivalence, whereas this one is assignment. So you've been making this distinction your whole mathematical life, more or less automatically. But now I'm telling you that there's a difference.
In MATLAB, the test for equivalence is a double equal. And in MATLAB, assignment is a single equal. So that's the meaning for this. Other programming languages have other symbology to mean these things. However, the equal and double equal is quite common for historical reasons. Okay, good. So now another matter is that, you know, I could write this. So how about 5 greater than 8? So is that an inequality?
Yes.
Yes. Not technically. Yes. It hurts. So yes, this is an inequality. Okay. Literally, in sort of the most abstract mathematical sense, what this is this operator, greater than, is a function that accepts two arguments, the one on the left and the one on the right, and it evaluates to true or false. So what's happening here is that, is this an evaluation of the greater than operator? Yes. Is it an inequality? Yes. Is it true?
No.
No, it's false. And there's nothing immoral or unethical about that.
Okay, how about this one? 5 less or equal to 8.
So is this an inequality?
Yes.
Yes. Is it true?
Yes.
Yes. So
similarly, so when I write this double dash, what I mean is the MATLAB prompt, because that's how MATLAB looks when you do it. So if we were to, at the MATLAB prompt, type 5 and then greater than, as in the greater than sign on your keyboard, 5 greater than 8. How will MATLAB respond to this?
Answer.
It'll say, nope. Okay. So what if we were to say to MATLAB, okay, 5, and now I want to write this. So notably, this one is your right ring finger with a shift, right? This one is on the keyboard. That one is not on the keyboard, right? Nevertheless, we want to be able to denote it. Okay, so the way you denote it is like this. Less than equal 8. So that is the less than symbol and then the equal symbol, and there's no space in between them. So how will MATLAB respond to this? It will say yes. Okay. So aside, that's aside number 1 and aside number 2. So now what we have, yes?
One minor point. Where it says like answer equals 0, is that a program we write, or if we just go to the command line and type that in, it'll default to some variable?
What I mean is that if you type this in to the command line, and then at this point you hit return,
MATLAB will respond with exactly this. So what it is that what this 5 equal 8 actually does is it produces a value. And if you do not say where you want that value to be stored, it gets stored in the variable named ANS.
Okay.
And then MATLAB responds with the present value of ANS is zero.
Is there some way to call up previous ANSs?
There is not, unless, because it gets overwritten.
Right.
So let me come back to that in about 1 minute. So the various true-false things, true-false evaluators that you need to know for MATLAB are these. So equal-equal does what we just talked about. There is greater than, there is less than, there is, we wrote, less than or equal. How do you suppose you write greater than or equal?
Greater than.
Yeah. Greater than, equal. And for now, these are all the ones we need to know. There's other things, but for now, these do what you suspect they do. Now, to address your question, you could do the following kind of weird thing, if you wished. You could say, okay, MATLAB, X is equal to 5 equal equal 8. You could write this. So let's back up just slightly and take a look at that. So those parentheses, they behave in exactly the same way as mathematics. They cause this thing to be evaluated first. And since this is the only thing, that's what happens. So 5 equal equal 8, how will MATLAB respond?
Zero.
Now, when we wrote it on the previous page, we just wrote it right here. And then MATLAB says, okay, so I evaluated this, and it evaluates to zero. Where do you want me to put it? You didn't tell me where to put it. My default place is to put it in the variable named ANS. Now, notice here what we did is we said, okay, MATLAB, I want you to evaluate this, and I'm telling you where I want you to put it. Where do we want MATLAB to put the evaluation? In X. So how will MATLAB respond to this?
It'll respond with X equal zero.
It does this thing. It puts the zero below that line for reasons that we'll get to later. Yes?
So is there no Boolean value, like some object called true or
not
false in MATLAB?
Wow. Not. For now, I'm going to say no.
Okay.
But the answer is, it depends on what you're doing. And generally speaking, the value zero will be reckoned as false and non-zero reckoned as true. Now, what if we do this? So just real quick, if we say X equal 5 equal equal 5, so how will MATLAB respond to this? It'll say, okay, X equal 1, because what you're saying is evaluate this. This evaluates to 1, stored in X. Okay, now here's a slight question. What will happen if we do this? X equal 5 less equal 8. And now the distinction. That. Yeah?
The semicolon suppresses the output. So X will be defined as this value, but it will not.
Correct. So in the first place, 5 less or equal 8, how does that evaluate?
1.
It evaluates to 1. So this is evaluates to 1. You're saying MATLAB put that in the value X, but MATLAB's not going to say X equal 1. It's just going to
come back to the prompt and say,
okay, do something else for me. So what this does is this semicolon suppresses the output. It means that I don't want you to respond, just do it. Okay, now, you could do some other stuff, right? So whatever you're doing here,
blah, 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 blah. And then as long as you didn't play with this value of x, as long as you didn't mess with it any further, you could now say, okay, MATLAB, now I need you to tell me what that x is. How will MATLAB respond to this? It'll say x is 1.
Okay. Good. So now we know how MATLAB has the relational operators. Now we need to figure out how to conditionally execute bits of code. Okay. So I think probably the best way to introduce it is by example. So let's say that for whatever reason, we're just really interested in the number 2370. That's just our favorite number. Okay? So here's a MATLAB function which returns true if we gave it 2370. Let's give it some different values. So write a function, write, has a T in it, write a function which returns, say, 800 when given 2370, and it returns say some other number, 500 otherwise. .2370 because that's our course number, 800 because the address of UTD is 800 West Campbell Road, 500 because I just couldn't think of anything else. Okay. So how about this? We'll give it some name. How about is_2370.m. So that's the name of the file. Okay, so we're making a function that does this business. So since it's a MATLAB function, what's the very first word in the file?
Function.
Function. And this function has a single output. So what do you want to name the output?
Y. Okay. But remember, there's nothing sacred about Y. So Y is it, what I mean is that we're so accustomed to saying Y is the output and X is the input, but understand that there's absolutely nothing sacred about those letters. Is 2370. What do you want to name the input?
A.
A, okay.
So the question is, and the requirement is, if A now is 2370, if that is the case, then we're supposed to return 800. Otherwise, we're supposed to return 500. Yes?
It's a very cool way you can do this without an if statement.
I agree, but I don't want to. That's not the point.
You want to use the if statement?
Yes.
Okay.
But I agree, but not going to do it. There's always very cool ways to do things. But right now we're trying to have a conditional statement. So
the way you write this in MATLAB is as follows. So
it starts out just like English, and I'm writing it. I wrote that keyword in red because it's a keyword. MATLAB reckons if as important. For example, you cannot name a variable if. You can name a variable, ix, that'd be fine, or jf, that'd be fine, but if is out of the question. Similarly, you can't name a variable function. Okay. So if the input a What we want to say is if the input is 2370, so what do I need to write?
Equal. And then what?
2370.
So if the input is 2370, we're going to do some stuff here. And then in English, I said otherwise,
but in MATLAB, you say else.
Else is also a keyword. And then the way that you
denote the end of the conditional is with, in MATLAB, you write end.
And the way that you denote the end of the function is
with end.
So now, our function's not doing anything useful yet. But what's happening here is that this is the general structure of what we want. So if the input is 2370, what are we supposed to do?
Return
800. And so what we need to do is we need to assign a value to the output symbol. The output symbol is y. So we need to give it a value. So y equal 800. Okay, what else?
Else y is 500.
Okay, any question about this one? So notably, let's ignore the first line for a minute. Notably, here we're using the test for equality, equal, and here we're using the assignment. Okay, so they're different, they're distinct in MATLAB. And then MATLAB has even another one, right? This equal is a syntax that's unrelated. So this equal is only used in the syntax to declare the signature of a function. Good. Any question about this? Okay. So we've got all the tools necessary to write a MATLAB function which evaluates factorial. And we're going to do it in the first way. We're going to do it, not this one. So now we're going to do this. We're going to do a MATLAB function that does this, and it's counting down instead of up. Okay, so this one's counting down, this one's counting up. We're going to do this one. Okay. So some of you are, I got a couple furled brows saying, wait a minute, we don't have enough, because you were expecting something else. Not yet. So what we want to do is we want to do something over and over and over again. The general topic for that is called iteration. Okay. There are two major but formally equivalent ways to accomplish iteration in programming languages. One of them is loops. We're not doing loops right now. What's the other one? Starts with R.
Recursion.
That one. Recursion. Right. So then, an example of recursion was on this page. Okay. So here's the definition, mathematical definition of factorial. It's called recursive because factorial is defined in terms of itself. It's defined in terms of itself, and then we have to have a base case where it stops. Okay. So we want a function which computes factorial and we're going to do this recursively.
and we're going to count down.
Okay, so let's see how to do it. So in the first place, very first thing, is we need to come up with a name. What do we want to call it?
Factorial.
Okay, factorial would be an excellent name, but we can't use it because MATLAB already has a function named factorial.
Sad?
Yeah. Okay, how about fact? So fact.m. So we're not gonna call it factorial because MATLAB already has one of those. Okay. So since this is a file that's going to contain a function, what is the very first thing?
Function.
Function.
Now, factorial is a function which accepts one non-negative integer input and produces one non-negative integer output. Now, we're going to ignore the part where we're worried about, well, what if someone plugs in something that's not an integer, like 3.2 or a banana or something. We're gonna ignore that for now. We're just going to assume that whoever's calling is not our adversary. Okay, so what do you want to name the output?
Sad.
Sad?
Sad.
Okay, I'm not gonna do that, but you can. But you can do that. So I'll make it M.
So the variable names literally are arbitrary. So with the exception that you can't use a keyword. In your own code, by all means, name them whatever thing you want, profane or otherwise. Okay? Whatever you want, I don't care. But for the purposes of the notes, I'm going to write M.
Okay? Equal to fact of N.
So, now let's look at the definition of factorial. So here's the mathematical definition of factorial. And we have two clauses. Can someone speculate as to how the causal nature will be encoded in MATLAB? Okay, thank you.
So if the input is 0,
if the input is 0, then what is the output?
M is 1. And again, not to strain the point too hard, do note the distinction between test for equality and instruction to assign a value. Thank you. Yes. Sorry, I got carried away with my rant there. Yes, 1.
Okay. But it may be otherwise. Okay. So to get into the second case, what do you write?
Else.
Okay, now, what we want to say is that else, the output is the product of two things, right? Else, the output is the product of two things. So,
what do I write?
N times n minus 1.
Okay, so n times, this is what I heard, times n minus 1.
So will that do it?
No.
It won't do it, because for example, if I passed in 10, it would say that the answer is 10 times 9. But that's not what we want, right? We don't want it to be 10 times 9. We want 10 times 9 times 8 times blah, 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 all of them.
So do we want to do
minus 1.
There you have it.
No.
N times fact N minus 1. End.
Yes?
So I'm just looking at it. Isn't it going to, no matter what, have just the output of 1? Because at the very last case, like let's say you start out with fact of 10 and then it was fact of 9 and then it goes down and down and down, you reset the value of m to just be 1.
We'll do that. We'll do the computation in a table in just a minute. Yes?
In our definition of a factorial, we have range restrictions, or I guess domain restrictions. Are we going to implement those?
Eventually, but that's what I meant is we're assuming right now that whoever's calling the function is your friend, not your adversary.
Okay.
So notably, if you were to pass in a banana or something, this would just crash. And if you were to pass in a negative value, it would never stop.
Or
a decimal or anything else, yes?
But then the function name be a keyword, like we had fact as function name and then fact
in
the function name cannot be a keyword. I don't understand your question.
Well, we have m equals fact n, and then we use fact
complex numbers.
Is that going to create a problem?
No.
Okay.
Because we're referring to this. So the fact that this function, the observation that this function is defined in terms of itself means that this function is recursive. Okay, it's recursive in the same way that this definition is recursive. Okay, so notably, this is the base case. So you don't really say base case in math classes until you get to a programming math class. So this is referred to as the base case. This is the case in which recursion stops. And this is the inductive case. That would be what you say in math classes, the inductive case or the recursive case. Yes?
So if the function name was bananas and it was bananas n, we would have m equals n times bananas n minus 1.
Yes.
Okay.
Yes. Okay, so now to your concern that this maybe is not doing what we expect it to do. Okay. But everyone else, but besides that, which I'm going to address presently, is there any other question? Okay. So how, in the end, I think the question is how does MATLAB implement this? So this is how MATLAB will do it. It'll say, so we've called, we're at the prompt here, at the MATLAB prompt, and let's say that we type fact of 5. Now we know for a fact that the answer should be 120. That's how MATLAB should respond, right? Now the question is how does MATLAB do this? How does MATLAB do it? Okay. So what MATLAB does is it reads this file and it says, "All right, I've got an M. I've got an M value. That's the output, and I've got an input N." So, what MATLAB does is it says, I've got a table, M and N. Now, M is never given a value until here. So what happens is that the value presently is unknown. So I'll denote this with, how do we want to denote unknown? I don't want. I'm just going to leave it blank. I'm going to leave it blank for now. A question mark. Okay, good. That's not syntax. I'll write a question mark. I was trying to think of something that couldn't be confused with syntax. Okay, so the value of m is unknown. The value of n is what? 5. Okay. So if this occurred, how would MATLAB execute? It would say, well, 5 equals 0. How about that?
False.
So then it would say, okay, all right, this is the block, the clause, that's going to get executed. So in order to do this, I need to do 5 multiplied by a value that is presently unknown. Okay, so the output will be 5 multiplied by an unknown value. 5 times an unknown value. So it doesn't know that. So MATLAB is going to pause the execution and say, okay, well, I need to continue here. And I'm going to give it the input 4. Okay, so now MATLAB's going to say, okay, how about is 4 equals 0?
No.
So that's false. So then it'll come here. And it'll say, well, whatever the answer is, it's 4 times some unknown value, a value that's not presently known. And I'm going to decrement n. So 3. Now we check. Okay, is 3 equals 0?
No.
No. So then whatever the answer is, it's 3 times some unknown value. We'll decrement this. And this process continues. 2 times some unknown value. We'll decrement this. And then, so then this will be 1 times some unknown value. We'll decrement this. And now, here's where it gets interesting. Is that now we're in the clause where we've called fact of 0. Well, what's going to happen finally here? We get a value, right? So when you call fact of 0, what happens is that now finally m has a value. And now what happens is that now function calls start returning. And what happens is that this 1 gets copied into this placeholder. Gets copied to that placeholder, and then that product finally gets evaluated. So this question mark, in a sense, gets replaced with a 1, then you do 1 times 1, and what is the answer?
1.
Then what happens? This value, which was formerly unknown, gets copied to here. So now that product is evaluable, and it evaluates to what?
2.
And then this unknown value, this formerly unknown value, gets copied into that position, and then evaluated. 3 times 2 is 6. This formerly unknown value gets copied to that position, and then 4 times 6, 24. I should have made my table a little wider than this. This one to here, 5 times 24 is 120. And then this one jumps all the way out to here. And MATLAB says the answer is 120. So now, sort of abstractly, we've been calling these rows in a table. Rows in a table. So now, the way that this works, sort of how MATLAB is doing it, because this function is recursive, we don't really need to know this because I don't want to get too much into computer science versus programming, which is the practice of actually getting stuff done. These rows, these individual rows, are referred to as stack frames.
So each of these is a stack frame.
And so what happens is a new stack frame gets pushed, push, 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 until you get to a base case, and then they get pop, 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 popped. Until, that's the language for it. Pushed onto a stack, and then take and then popped off the stack. And then what's finally popped off the function call is 120. Yes?
Is there a maximum level of recursion or stack frames?
There is a maximum recursion depth, and for MATLAB, it is on the order of tens of thousands.
Oh.
Yes?
So if you took away the semicolons from the function, would it print all the intermediate
values? It would print all the intermediate values. And it's a good idea, at least when you're initially writing a function, to leave off some of the semicolons strategically so that you can see, yeah, it's doing what I think. However, when you write a function, it is bad form for your function to print anything out to the console. And it is a graded element, which is to say that my test case will say, you need to make your function be quiet, more or less. It'll say, stop printing stuff, console. But when you're trying to get it figured out, it's definitely a good strategy. Okay, so any question about this? So this is a recursive definition of the factorial function. So there's lots of things that can be done recursively. Okay, another example would be adding up the numbers 1 to n, say. Like there's all math majors should know the story about Gauss. I'm not sure that the story is actually true, but there's a mathematician named Gauss. He was a very good mathematician, and in the story anyway, very unruly child. And so he's really smart and not following the teacher's instructions. And the teacher says, "Okay, Mr. Gauss, look, go to the corner, and I want you to add up all the numbers, 1 to 100, and don't come back to me until you're finished." And he thinks about it for a moment and says, 5,050. And of course he's right. And the teacher is just totally exasperated, right? It's a lovely story. It's probably not even close to true. Okay? Now, so what the teacher expected of Mr. Gauss in the story anyway is wanted him to do, okay, 1 plus 2 is 3, plus 3 is 6, plus 4 is 10. You know, and then just keep adding up all the numbers until you get, till you finally say plus 100 is 5,050. That's what the teacher wanted from him. That's not what he did. But do you understand how that we could in principle do that with recursion? We could say, okay, we're starting with this initial value. We're going to add up all the numbers. Okay, so I could say like, you could write a function called say Gauss, and I could pass in n. And you could say, well, the answer is n plus Gauss of n minus 1. It would be just like this. N plus Gauss of n minus 1. Yes?
Would we be penalized if we did it the way Gauss actually did it?
So what's actually going to happen is that you're going to make a multitude of implementations of these functions. Okay. I'll say, I want you to do it recursively, counting down. I want you to do it recursively, counting up. I want you to do it with a loop, counting down. I want you to do it with a loop, counting up. I want you to do it with the formula. So all of them. So by the way, how did Gauss do it?
It's sum of sigma to n is n plus 1 times n over 2.
Well, yes, that's the Gauss function.
He matched up the last and first element. So 1 plus 99 is 100, so is 2 plus 98. So you can work for both ends.
Yeah, almost, right? So 1 plus 100 is 101. 2 and 99 is 101. 3 and 98 is 101. 4 and 97 is 101. And then you just work them to the middle. And how many such pairings can you make? 50 of them. And 50 times 101 is 5,050. Oh, Mr. Gauss. Causing problems back in the day for Mrs. Harris. Okay. So any questions about this? Yes?
How would you recursive counting up?
We'll have to see. Okay, so have a nice Tuesday.